My name is Thomas Murray. I'm a member of the Worker Solidarity Movement. I'm one of the organisers of the Dublin Anarchist Book Fair. I want to welcome you to this afternoon for the final panel session that will take place here in the Generator on community grassroots struggles, with a particular emphasis on housing and water struggles. So we know it, the crisis of the last few years, that you know, capitalism in Ireland has tried to shift the costs of financial crisis onto the rest of us in the form of privatising water or introducing water charges or cutting social housing stocks. So today I'm really delighted to have this opportunity to facilitate a discussion. We're joined by Mick Byrne of the Provisional University, who is also a member of the Dublin Tenants Association and a researcher of housing issues in Ireland. He'll speak first. He'll be followed by Brian Fagan of Kildare's opposition to water charges, as well as the Irish Housing Network. He's also a member of the Worker Solidarity Movement, where he'll talk about recent struggles against both water charges and against or for housing. And finally, we'll be joined by Aisling Hederman of the North Dublin Bay Housing Crisis Communities and also of the Irish Housing Network. And of course, all our speakers here are very familiar to us from being out on the streets over the last number of years and met them countless times on demonstrations and marches. So we'll have brief presentations and then we'll open it up for questions and answers from the floor. Okay, so without further ado, I'll hand you over to Mick. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Tom.
You'll get one at the end as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Aurelian, Tom, and thanks to the all the organisers of the Book Fair for putting on a great weekend. I was delighted to be asked to come along to this panel in particular because I've been involved in the Dublin Tenants Association for the last year or so, where we're trying to put together a particular form of our approach to grassroots and community organising, and through that a lot of kind of interests and reflections and discussions have come up, and also a lot of, I suppose, problems or questions that we still have and that we're trying to think about on an ongoing basis. So what I want to talk about, I suppose, is something that one of the things that is kind of at the heart of what we do in the Dublin Tenants Association, which is how we relate to tenants who come to us with a particular housing problem. And the main thing I want to talk about today is the politics of that relationship and different approaches to it. But I'll begin by just talking about what the Dublin Tenants Association is. So we set ourselves up about a year and a half ago, in response to the fact that the private rented sector was clearly the epicentre of the housing crisis. And also because lots of people in our communities were experiencing rent increases, evictions and other issues. There was a period where it felt like everybody we knew was having to look for another place to live. So we came together to create a space where tenants could come to fight for their rights effectively. And that's basically the heart of what we do. But we, you know, we set that up, and what we do is we meet once a week, we educate ourselves about our rights as tenants and about the obligations of landlords, we educate ourselves about housing policy, we also do small bits of campaigning, so far mainly in the media, but we want to expand that, and people, individuals who are experiencing a particular issue with their housing in the private rented sector can get in touch with us, and we provide support and information around, say, a rent increase, eviction, poor quality accommodation, and all that kind of thing. So it's a place where tenants can come together to fight for their rights in a very everyday, practical sense, in terms of all the stuff of negotiating with your landlord or taking a case to the Private Residential Tenancies Board against your landlord, but also a place where tenants can come together to fight for their rights in a more big picture sense, which is about changing government policy, which is about challenging the structures which cause tenants to be excluded from the right to housing. So that's what we do. And so there's kind of lots of interesting stuff that comes up as part of that work. But what I wanted to focus in on, as I say, is this whole issue of how the people who are members of the association are kind of core activists, if you like, how we relate to people who get in touch with us with a particular issue that they have and the politics of that. And from the beginning, we were pretty clear that we didn't want to interact with people in what you might call a traditional activist way, for the want of a better term, right? So we're not trying to, when people get in touch with us, we're not trying to convince them of a particular set of ideas. We're not trying to convince them or explain to them that the cause of the housing crisis is neoliberalism or capitalism, nor are we trying to get them to adopt a particular set of views about what the solution would be, for example, you know, socialism or anarchism or what have you. So we're not trying to do that. We're not trying to recruit people or get them to adopt a set of ideas. But we're also not just about providing information to people. It's not just the case that we say, well, here are your rights in this situation. This is how you should try and solve your problem. And then they get that information and advice and they go off and that's the end of the story. Because we do want to be about transformation and about radical change. And we want tenants who come into contact with us to change and to change radically, right? In the specific sense that we want tenants to experience and be part of a process of collective empowerment, right? Now, what I mean by collective empowerment is that by working with others, we can enhance our capacity to shape the material world that we live in and the things that affect our lives, right? So that's what I mean by that. So we want this, when people get in touch with us because they've got a rent increase or whatever, and they meet with us or they come to a meeting or whatever, we want this somehow to be part of a process or an experience for them which empowers them and which enhances their sense that by working together we is the best way for us to change the reality of our housing situation. But there's just one other aspect of that I'd like to underline, which is that we want tenants who come to us to change, right? But we also want to change ourselves, because we're just as powerless and as fucked as the people who come to us with their problems. It's not that we, you know, when we have rent increases, we're just as vulnerable as the tenants who come. We are just as powerless to shape government policy as the tenants who come to us. So it's not that we have, you know, power and we give it to them, or that we have the answers and we give them the answers. It's about creating a process which is a process of reciprocity and a mutual support process in which we come together and both sides, if you like, the tenants association as a group and new people getting involved or people who come to us with issues, in which both sides are empowered. Okay, so for me, this is really what self-organizing is about, right? As a particular type of grassroots political practice. It's about creating processes and practices which make possible the experience of collective empowerment around our material needs. That's for me what it's all about. And for me, this is the most important and the most politically radical thing we can do today in the current context. But in order to give a more of a sense of what that means in practice, but also to show that it's quite a messy and a complicated process, I want to give a bit of a story of different approaches that we've adopted and the kind of strengths and limits we found with each one, because we've tried different ways of going about this and it hasn't been all plain sailing, right? There's been problems and there's been a learning process. So I just want to talk briefly about that and give two examples. When we started with one approach to dealing with tenants and dealing with their housing issues, right? And that approach was, somebody would usually email us or contact us on Facebook and they'd say, I'm being evicted or whatever. We'd say, come along to our meeting, Tuesday, 7 p.m, Parish Centre on Prussia Street, just up the road. So the tenant comes along to the meeting. We're all sitting around the table. They then have an opportunity in the context of the meeting to talk about their problem that they have and their situation. Then collectively, we would ask them questions. When did you move in? Do you have a lease? Is your landlord registered with the PRTB, etc.? And then we collectively would kind of brainstorm the solution or the strategy around that person's problem. After that process, which took about between 20 and 40 minutes, one person from the tenants association would then be kind of paired up with that tenant, and they would go off and separate from the meeting, and then they would discuss how to actually implement that strategy. And the idea was the next week the tenant would come back and say, this is what I did, this is how it went, what are the next steps, and so on. Okay, so that was the process. Now, the benefit of that process was, from our point of view, it was very, very collective. The tenant, from their first contact, was with a collective group of people. They were sharing their housing situation with a group of people, many of whom had experienced similar stuff. And the discussion and the strategizing was also collective, right? So it really reflected that desire we had to make this be about collective, to make this be about collective empowerment. The weakness of the thing was, it was quite daunting for the tenant to come into a room full of people you don't know and talk about something that is really, really stressful for you. That was one thing. It was quite confusing for the tenant. Why are we doing this in a group? That was, you know, and obviously, you know, when somebody comes to you with a housing issue, you can't start to explain to them, well, we have this idea about collective empowerment. It's not the time or the place, right? So there has to be a tangible and a practical reason for why you're doing something in a particular way that's of value to the tenant, right? And the other thing was, the tenants wanted clear, concise information pretty quickly. This didn't deliver that. They just didn't do it, okay? So this approach was great on collective empowerment, but it was a bit weaker on being practical and pragmatic and tenant oriented around the tenant's experience and the tenant's reality. So then we switched about 4 months ago to another approach, which was, I suppose, we swung in the opposite direction. So what we did was the tenant would ring or email or whatever, and one individual would deal with the tenant from the start. That individual would arrange to meet the tenant one-on-one outside the meeting, and they would basically give the tenant the information they needed and advise them as to how to approach their situation and then work with the tenant on implementing that strategy, right? This was really, really effective at getting tenants to get in touch with us and to meet with us. It was really effective in giving tenants the information they needed, and it meant that a lot of tenants actually bought into that process. And we ended up taking a lot of cases to the PRTB and winning all of the cases that we took to the PRTB, right, for the tenant. So this approach was great because it was efficient and effective. And they're really important things. That's just as important as being radical and being political, if not more important. Because if your process isn't efficient and effective, people are not going to waste their time with you. The people don't want to hear waffle, okay? So those things were great. That was brilliant. But where was the collective empowerment? The tenants never got to meet the other members of the Tenants Association. They never got to see, most importantly, the collective work that was actually making possible us knowing the solution to their problem or knowing how to approach it, and us as activists getting the support from other people to bring their cases to the PRTB and win. They didn't get to see that. And there was also limited opportunities for the tenant to get more involved in the association because they didn't see what was going on, they didn't meet people, they didn't get to feel part of it. So we are now moving on to our third approach to this whole question. And if you want to find out what that is, you'll have to come to our meeting, which is on Tuesday at 7 p.m. in the Parish Centre on Prussia Street. And you can go to dublintenants.wordpress.com or email dublintenants@gmail.com. And we really need people to get involved because we've way more work than we can handle. So it's an ongoing thing. But the key point I want to make is, right, that if we're thinking about doing stuff at a grassroots level and we're thinking about self-organising, what I think we need to focus in on is actually experimenting with, trying to come up with ways and experimenting ways in which somebody can go from having an individual issue where they go, fuck, I'm getting evicted, coming into contact with your organisation, and through that contact, being able to experience a process of collective empowerment. That means that the person feels better able to shape the reality of their lives having participated or through participating in this process. And that means that the person gets a sense of the fact that if we come together and work together, it's not just something we might do because of an ideology we have or an ethical position we have or whatever. It's something that we can do to actually enhance our capacity to shape the lives that we have, and specifically to access the right to housing, which is what we're about. But that process is about figuring things out, and it's about experimentation. It's a slow process. It doesn't happen quickly. There's not immediate results. But if we don't do that, if we don't do that hard work of experimenting with different ways to make that happen, I think we'll never build strong collectives, strong movements based on what I've just been talking about.
Okay.
Thanks a million, everyone.
Thanks very much. Okay. I've just noticed that there are a few people like standing at the back. It's possible if some people want to come and sit up here at the front. We've done that for previous panels. Or if people who are sitting on couches want to squish in and make space as well. Because there may be people in later on as well. Okay, thanks for that. Next up, we have Brian Fagan, as I said, who's been very heavily involved in campaigns, grassroots campaigns against water charges and for the housing struggle, as well as being a member of the Workers' Solidarity Movement. So, Brian, if you want to take it away, we'd welcome it to.
Hi everybody, how's it going? My name's Brian from Kildare. I'm a member of the WSM, like Tom says, and also a member of Scrap the Water Charges Kildare. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to talk a little bit about my own experiences rather than spending most of my time talking generally about the water charges. I'm just going to talk mainly about my own campaign experiences because I think that's probably, hopefully, what you'll find the most interesting. So the current situation around the water charges and Irish Water is that Irish Water are seriously on the back foot. I'm sure that in the media you've probably all seen numerous reports of how much trouble Irish Water is in as a company. They failed the Eurostat test. The boycott is going really strong. The last figures that we had, which were months ago, admittedly, because they haven't been releasing any new figures because obviously they're quite bad and getting worse, was more than 50% for the boycott. And that was before, that was months and months ago, and things have just been going downhill for them since then. So, I mean, in terms of how the battle is going up until now, it's actually been going fairly well. The boycott has been successful. Irish Water failed the Eurostat test. Eurostat is like a central statistics office for Europe, for the EU. And basically, Irish Water was set up in order to become what's called a market corporation. They needed to pass the Eurostat test to become a viable market corporation so that they could be classified as not part of the state, not part of the state, basically, so they could, so the government could more easily borrow money. So they failed that test. So the rationale for actually setting up Irish Water, the official rationale for setting up Irish Water, that's pretty much gone now. Obviously, the kind of unofficial rationale for setting up Irish Water was part of the neoliberal agenda of privatisation, because if you set up a company, you get people paying into it, paying the charges into it, then down the line what you can do is you can obviously just sell that off very easily to transnational water companies, who will then obviously jack up the price massively, because it's like Goldman Sachs said, water is blue gold. It's kind of where a lot of capital should really be focusing their investment, because it's such a valuable resource, obviously, and people need it. So yeah, I mean, nationally, in terms of how the campaign is going, it's going really well. There's a huge amount of resistance. Tens of thousands of people have been out in the streets. Massive amounts of direct action occurring. Huge amounts of efforts by the media to portray water protesters as violent thugs, or like that famous phrase that they tried to popularize as a sinister fringe, which was actually just kind of quite funny as it turned out. So, I mean, where we are now is there are talks happening in the government. Because the boycott is so successful, they're thinking, all right, primary strategy didn't work. From their point of view, they're thinking primary strategy didn't work. How are we going to get people to still pay? They're probably going to, or at least they're talking about, integrating the property tax, which is actually a tax which can be taken from source, from your wages, which is different than the water charges, which is like a utility bill, so it can't really be taken from your wages so easily. It's like trying to take your Sky bill from your wages. It's kind of, it just wouldn't really work. So they're talking about trying to merge those. What that would mean is that a boycott would be harder, but at the same time, it would make privatization harder from their point of view. But maybe they would be happy with just getting more money out of us, even if it kind of makes privatization harder from their point of view. So that's kind of the situation at the moment. My campaign group, Scrap the Water Charges, Kildare, I'm just going to talk about that a little bit, where that came from, and some of our experiences in organizing various direct actions and trying to build the boycott locally. So the Scrap the Water Charges campaign really came directly out of the Kildare campaign against the household charge and property tax, which ultimately, as most of you probably know, nationally was it didn't succeed. The property tax is established. It's now actually in place. So we didn't succeed in stopping it. But the campaign wasn't in vain. The campaign against home and water charges was definitely not in vain, because even though we didn't win like a strategic victory and get our goal of defeating the property tax and the household charge, we did build up this vast network of newly politicized people who were, after getting huge new levels of experience in everything from how to organize a public meeting, experience in going door knocking as a group. And I mean, I don't know if you've ever been door knocking, but if someone suggested that to you and you've never done it before, that can seem quite daunting. But once you've done that, then suddenly that just becomes something that you can do. That's, you just know when someone suggests that, okay, I can do that. It's putting up posters, doing leaflets, doing all kinds of pickets. The experience that people gained during that campaign against household and water charges really stood to us when it came to the water charges campaign. But initially, because we had lost, we actually felt exhausted, because we had been campaigning for like 2.5-3 years on something, and then we lose. I mean, that's not really good for morale, you know. But I think the thing that there were probably three things that really kind of tied it together and really made the water charges, the anti-water charges campaign, kind of explode out of the gates. It was that we had built up a huge level of experience, so we had a layer of experienced campaigners. Then with the water charges coming in, I think it was kind of starting to kick off in kind of mid to late 2014. That's when things started to really, you could see the momentum building up. The water meter contractors were coming in and installing meters, and people were starting to resist them. You saw photos of, say, maybe an elderly couple sitting inside those kind of excavation safety barriers, the big kind of orange safety barriers you see around any kind of excavations on the street, sitting inside having a cup of tea, and then suddenly the lads can't use the excavating machinery because there's an elderly couple sitting inside, and you just can't do your work. So, I mean, obviously that was extremely popular. So you had Then, as well as that kind of direct action happening, that was extremely popular and was shared around on social media a lot, you also had the massive demonstration that I don't think anybody really saw coming. I think it was October 11th, 2014, and everyone was up at the Garden of Remembrance, and it was just a huge number of people, which I don't think any of us expected. There was just a massive surge in energy. You just felt like this is like really actually not like some funeral marches that you sometimes get on the left, you know, the really horrible things to be at. But this is like a really, like a new layer of people, huge level of enthusiasm, creativity, just really cool banners. People were making even like tinfoil kind of taps that they're wearing on their heads. I mean, it's just like this new layer of kind of creativity and energy coming in. So really kind of good to see. So I think, with the water charges campaign getting started, you had that veteran layer of activists from the campaign against home and water charges. You had direct action from even elderly people. I mean, and then you had this new layer of people who were very enthusiastic about getting started. And those people were actually starting up campaign groups where there had, in localities and locations where there had actually been no recent history of resistance to anything really. So they were kind of sprouting up all over the place. You saw it more happening on Facebook than anywhere else, but you kind of know that that was kind of groups starting to seed around the place, and people would kind of build their campaigns off the Facebook communication platform. But those things all kind of came together to really boost the energy of the veteran campaigners from the campaign against home and water charges, who, like I said, were really demoralized. But now you have suddenly direct action happening, you've got a new layer of people, loads of enthusiasm, and then you have all the experience of the veteran campaigners from the previous campaign, which wasn't successful, but like I said, had built up such a level of experience and confidence when it comes to political organizing. So, I mean, the campaign just really seemed to just take off, obviously, because it's like you can kind of see it throughout the media, how widespread it was, how militant the direct action was, blockades of water meter contractors. You can see people like when the contractors come out to install meters, people will literally come and climb on their equipment, or they will take the safety barriers away, or they will just stand too close to the equipment that it can be safe, that it, so it can't be safely operated. All kinds of direct action like that. I think in Kildare there wasn't actually that much direct action. It was kind of difficult for us because a lot of us were actually like in full-time employment, so like you would get contact via our Facebook page that would say, okay, there are water meter contractors in such and such an estate, and you would try to get one or two people out there, but usually by the time you managed to get people out there, the water meter contractors were actually gone. So for us, direct action wasn't really didn't really take place to the degree that it happened in other communities, unfortunately. But at the same time, we still had like probably some of the biggest, well, I would say actually almost certainly the biggest marches in like the history of say Kildare Town and Newbridge Town in Kildare, which is where we were primarily organizing. It was some of the older people involved in the campaign just said that there'd never been anything like this in the town. This is like unprecedented, really. So when you have that level of confidence, enthusiasm, and just such a widespread campaign against something that is so generally hated, it's like such an easy thing to sell. It really is. Like you have like rakes of cars going down the street beeping at you. You've got people gladly coming over to you taking leaflets from you. The only time people didn't take leaflets from us is when they thought we were evangelical Christians. But then they came back and was like, sorry, I thought you were evangelical Christians. Yeah, I'll take one of those. It was a very easy campaign to sell. And I think the benefits of it, for us at least, were that you just get such political experience organizing such a wide amount of different events, from public meetings, which would be like, say, this one, you get try and get the community all into one place, and then give information that's relevant to the campaign, because it's kind of critical. When those started to kind of drop off for us, so actually what we did was we started having street meetings, which we actually learned from Facebook, from the Dunleary campaign. I think they were actually starting to have street meetings, and we were thinking, okay, that might work because people aren't coming to the public meetings anymore. So we just went out to people's, like the green area at the front of your estate. We would just leaflet just one estate or two estates, and you'd literally put up like four posters or something. So it's way less effort than an actual public meeting. And you would then get everyone coming out onto their front green. Hopefully it's not raining. And you have them in their own area on their turf. They're much more confident when it comes to asking questions. You've got the whole kind of neighbor kind of experience, the whole community kind of experience coming together. They all feel that, like, all right, all my neighbors are here. We all have a problem with this. If we have any questions, we can ask. There's a campaign group here that we can actually join if we like have the time or the energy to do that. So like actually having those street meetings was something that we learned from a different group, something that turned out to be really, really effective. And I think it's probably one of the main reasons that we were able to build up such an effective campaign in Kildare, is because you learn from other groups, you work with other groups, you get your fundraising ideas from different groups. So it just was, I think, much more of an autonomous campaign than the previous campaign, but it was, it's like, yeah, I mean, it's totally different from the previous campaign, which is kind of like a hierarchical structure. This one's much more decentralised, and you're kind of learning in a networked way from all the other campaigns. So I've been told to wrap up, so I think I'll actually wrap it up at that before I keep going, because I could.
Thank you. Okay, thanks, Brian. I forgot to say at the start, we had intended to have a speaker from Cork, and Brian reminded me that a lot of those first... you know, images that were shared on Facebook were actually, I think, from the Mahon campaign or from Cork. Barbara Flood was due to come up here, but she had to cancel at the last moment and sends her apologies. Barbara is working instead with, she's in Calais at the moment working on a refugee solidarity project. So we wish her well with that. Okay, so our last speaker is Aisling Hederman from the North Dublin Bay Housing Crisis Communities. As well as the Irish Housing Network. So I just want you to welcome her here.
I hate public speaking, but anyway, I'm here today to learn just as much as I hope anyone else can learn from my experience on the kind of activism that we've been involved in for the last 2 years, our group, North Dublin Bay Housing Crisis Community, and also with the Irish Housing Network. Personally, I'm just a mammy with two children, and they're a handful, but they make it worth it because that's the reason why we do it. To give you a little insight to why I got involved, I was made redundant during the recession, lost my job, ended up on social benefits, and it also helped create and suffer from mental health illnesses, which I felt that was lacking services that I couldn't access. So all the anger from what happened in the past has helped lead us to get involved with more activism within the community. Who's North Dublin Bay Housing Crisis Community? So basically we are just a group of parents from Coolock area, Artane area, that came together to kind of bring about awareness, education and support to different housing things that were happening in the area. Like what people were saying, Mick was saying, your friends were coming to you, your family members were coming, and everybody was giving out, but no one knew what to do or where to go or who to contact. We found that the services were lacking on information, that you couldn't find the information, that you were going to get source this information and you were felt rejected. So when you were leaving, you were actually kind of on your own, no matter what housing situation that you were in. We became community-based. We linked into all the community services. We set up a Facebook page. And like that, cases start coming through on an individual basis that we were dealing with. We are non-politically aligned for the reasons that we don't want to get messed up with all the politicians' ideologies and their political kind of policies that they want to push and force on people, like the privatisation of housing. We felt that privatisation of housing is taken away from everybody's right, and because we're suffering because of the recession, that our children are not going to have a hope in hell in the future to be able to fight back or to be able to kind of, without being politically kind of influenced, if that's the only way that we could see was happening, like people are getting politically influenced and not actually doing it for themselves, they were actually doing it for an agenda. So what happened then was we felt that the housing crisis was so big and we couldn't manage it. We wanted to link in with more because we were kind of just suffering from the private sector and homelessness kind of area. So we did have people coming to us with mortgage distress, and we hadn't got a clue about how to direct them or get the service for them. And same with taking PRTB cases and fighting for your rights. But we do encourage you. So we linked in with other groups across Facebook. Social media is great for starting off. So we linked in with other groups across social media, and North Dublin Bay then held a public meeting because we felt that all these groups could come together and help our community because they were so diverse. So we had the public meeting, and from that then we did a few direct actions, which led to the Irish Housing Network being formed. The Irish Housing Network is a collection of different groups that ideally are non-politically affiliated. They are made up of community kind of activists, those that are affected, that it's not led by for an agenda or for a reason to privatise any housing. So basically we felt that the media was using the term loosely around housing crisis. Politicians are using the term loosely around housing crisis. So it was time to get really organising and start taking actions for what was happening. Within North Dublin Bay, we did decide how can we do an action without it being those affected, because we can't do an action and say, oh, we're doing this for you and you not wanting that action to happen. So we set up support groups. And it's through the support group like that we meet. We have an individual contact first of all through Facebook or through a phone call, have a chat, see what your situation is. We try and signpost you, so it's basically signpost to the services that are already in place by the state. If them say services, so we leave it open for you to come back and discuss like what the services haven't been able to deliver, what the problems are within the services, how to kind of come back to our group and kind of say, look, this didn't work for me, it's lacking this. With that then we can direct them to the support group. In the support group mainly you do find an awful lot of people are having problems with the services, so we can sit there and we can talk about the problems till the day of the end, and it's not going to fix them at the end of the day. The problems are going to still be there. What we found was we kind of connect with each other more so on emotions. People are forgetting completely, like, it's completely emotional. They're getting distracted by materialistic things. They're getting distracted by what's going on the news. They're getting distracted by social media, distracted by the phones, clothes, pop stars. You can see it in my children, do you know what I mean? So they're completely distracted by what's going on. So it's about stripping it back to kind of the humanitarian kind of procedure, kind of sit there, talk about how you were feeling, kind of describing the emotions, because people forget actually what fear is, like, because they're in fear constantly. And that's what we found is the biggest problem around organising within the housing movement, or kind of anything to do with trying to build up resistance towards the services that are not delivering, was basically that it's emotional, it's fear. And if you look at it, you can see it right through. You can see it through mortgage distress, fear of the banks, fear of going to the courts because you've never been in trouble before with the law. And then all of a sudden you're in a courtroom in front of a judge. That's fear. You can see a fear of losing your home, going to the PRTB, fighting a big landlord, fighting a big developer, fighting a vulture fund. That's fear. Then you have losing your home, going into emergency accommodation. If you're going into emergency accommodation, you're facing these frontline workers that deal every day. They come across cold-hearted, they don't have the right information, they don't have the services because we are lacking funding. There is no emergency accommodation. You're told to go out and look after what you have to look after. We feel that with the fear, it's a way of talking to each other. We need to talk to each other a lot more. I think that we need to really touch out to each other, give each other hugs, whatever it has to be, just to get that human element back into kind of understanding and compassion. Because if you don't have understanding and compassion, you're not going to have any kind of understanding of what someone's experience actually is. And from that, once you build up your kind of, yeah, you get a trust from it. And once you build up the trust, then it's easy and a lot easier for the girls then, or the lads. There's not a lot of men coming towards us now that are able to say, well, I'm not on my own. And they can actually relate them with the experience of the services lacking, and we can find a commonality in that. So from the support group, what we find is that anyone that comes and they find a common issue that is problem with, we try to say, well, what are the options? And we don't push anything on them. They come up most likely with a direct action that they would like to take. So we have been involved like in occupying the local councils, we have been involved in occupying the vault, we have been involved in occupying different things, protesting. And what we find is, yeah, it mightn't be a systematic change. At the end of the day, it's an individual change, and that's what we have to look for. We need to look after each other so your individual need is actually met. And from that, what we hope is once they have succeeded in that individual change, then all of a sudden it can grow, because it will be like, right, it worked for you, it should work for 10 of us. So if 10 of us are then getting the same kind of thing, it should grow out much further. So recently, for example, what we're doing now is the support group is going to DCC on a weekly, Dublin City Council, if anyone doesn't know what that is, on a weekly basis now, on a Wednesday from 11 to 1. And these girls from the support group are leading this. We're just helping them get the information out or whatever it is that they want us to do. And they go there and they sit there between 11 to 1 and they demand to see the executives now, because it's the executives that are actually in charge of the policy making and making the decisions, and they're the ones that actually have the power. So what we want to do is sit there between them hours to kind of put the pressure on them and grow it. So next week we're hoping to have 10, and then the week after that we're hoping to have 15, and that people don't feel so alone and that they can actually come together. So basically, that's how we feel that the growth of North Dublin Bay between the grassroots activism can grow through support groups. We do direct them as well to the services, you know what I mean? It's kind of, the services are there. We don't want to replace the services. We don't want to become a service. We're not getting paid to, like, we're doing this voluntary, but we don't want to become a paid organisation. We want to make sure that people are empowered, that they're lifted up from the bottom, that they do feel that they can take on somebody that they feel is in power. Because at the end of the day, the system might think it has the power, right? But we together can smash that system.
Okay, we're going to open it up for questions, but just before we do, unfortunately we haven't smashed the system just yet. So first one here.
I wish we were in a position ready to smash the system. The real thing, we're on the defensive. This is a major assault on working people, and not only here in Ireland, similar experience in many other countries. Now, but I want to particularly mention the water and the housing is also part of that offensive. But we had a previous experience of agitation over bin tax. Nobody mentioned privatisation, or very few. I didn't hear it. But that was the purpose of putting on the bin tax, so it could be sold off, so we could enrich some of the cronies of the political class. And who got it? They're mafia. They burn each other's money. But small mafia will not get hold of the water. They'd be serious major players. And I think there is no doubt at all that the purpose of the water charges is not just to make to broaden the tax and make the poor people pay more tax so the rich can pay less. That's not the main purpose. The main purpose of it is to prepare for privatisation. And they've shown to be very patient. That especially coming up before the election, the government has said very little about water, and now you have the feel of all parties said, we're going to wait 5 years and then we're going to hit you. And then we're going to sell it off. As said, the only guarantee we can have, which we have to press, is for a constitutional amendment. That would be one thing that would prevent this, because they are patient, they are prepared to wait until the, and unfortunately, coming up to the election, the water campaign, some of the steam went out of the water campaign. For a obvious reasons, because people were concerned with getting elected. But now, with the interim, when we still haven't got a proper government, now is the time for a big impetus on the water issue to push against the water charges, and especially for a constitutional amendment to stop it being privatised ever.
So we take two more points, or
sorry, that wasn't the question.
Yeah, we'll take two more questions then, and then ask the panel for some responses. So, are there any other questions?
I wonder if maybe Brian could talk a little bit more about what you were saying at the end about autonomy, because it seems like that's really important. Why having a more autonomous campaign against the water charges made a difference, perhaps, to the overall struggle, and also what direction it might have going forward and implications for other movements.
Okay. Do you have another question? Yeah.
So, a housing question: does anybody know what's happened with the modulars?
Okay. We might start with Mick and then work this one.
I don't have anything to add, really.
Not on the modular housing? Or?
Not really, no.
Okay, right.
All right. The current campaign against the water charges is fairly different in structure than the previous campaign against home and water charges. The campaign against home and water charges was set up by left-wing parties and groups, including the WSM, to basically try and get something started around the property tax, and it did. But the way it was set up, the structure was kind of there in place, had already been set up and kind of agreed upon by the left-wing kind of parties and groups beforehand. And basically, you had a kind of a federation of new groups. When a new group would form, that group would send delegates to a national steering committee meeting, which would happen every few weeks. So it was kind of very centrally controlled from the start, although obviously the groups were largely autonomous, but there was this constant national steering committee structure that was on it, which in some ways was quite annoying, because you know the way, like, political parties, like, if you have two different political parties and they see this new layer of people, they're thinking, okay, how many activists can I poach out of this for the next election? That's generally the way they look at it, and that's kind of the way they conduct themselves, with a view to getting a few more activists, getting a bit more publicity, with the eye on the next election. So that kind of led to different tensions within the campaign, or within those national steering committee meeting groups, which was actually quite demoralizing for our group anyway, and I'm sure for other groups as well. The good thing about the current campaign is it was much more kind of a case of not being started out, initiated by left-wing groups. It kind of just started to pop up all over the place. Some of the groups came out of that campaign against home and water charges, like our own one, but in a lot of places they just kind of started popping up around the place. And it was much more of a kind of horizontal kind of network, rather than that kind of centralized structure where it was formal and kind of a federal kind of structure. So that just meant that you didn't have to put up with the kind of nonsense that you usually have to from political parties. So I think that was just a huge morale boost, basically. You didn't have to waste your time, and you didn't have to put up with the negativity to your morale of going to those meetings and having to interact with those political parties. So it was just much better from that perspective, I think.
Ashton, did you want to come in on anything that was said?
The modulars, I might have something in. So for those that are following the story of the modular units, it's recently come out that the prices have increased from 100,000 to 240,000 per unit. And that's not including the land costs on that site in Ballymun. It was met resistance, there was protests, and there was alternatives as well with the co-ops, that they ended up losing the land because the modulars were replaced, and apparently the council had no say, and that's their saying. But the costs are manifesting every day due to the fact of delays, and they said that they would be done really fast. We went to see them, actually, the other modulars, these are rapid builds, they're calling them now, so they changed the name. When they first came out, they were to be modular units, like a porter cabin kind of style. We went and viewed them, they were absolutely fabulous, but we did feel that if you were, the areas that they had picked for them to put into were disadvantaged areas, and they were going to go in 40s and 50s into the disadvantaged areas, which will create more of a kind of ghetto-sized community with the services already lacking, and cut funding cut as well. So you'd be putting vulnerable families back into disadvantaged areas that can't access services for mental health, childcare, schools, etc. So with the modulars now, it's been a story to be followed, because they're using it as kind of the alternative to the hotels and B&Bs and the hostels. We do need an alternative. They are a good idea in theory, but we know from failed policies before that they are going to turn to be long term. They are not going to be short term. If you move into that and you're a vulnerable homeless family and you're there for 6 months, you're going to want to stay. You're not going to want to move and uproot your family after linking into the services that are there. Your making friends with the neighbours, your children making friends and stuff like that. So we feel that the modulars, the idea of them going into disadvantaged areas is wrong. If they were to use them as short term, they should be scattered right across the city. They shouldn't be just stigmatised them into the disadvantaged areas. They have got plots of land all over the place. They can't be just using this as an excuse to kind of separate. They're creating a three-tier system with the modulars. And with the three-tier system, you can see if you're poor, you're going to be homeless and you're going to be in a timber-framed house. If you're middle class, you're going to be private renting with no security of tenure and no security or whatever for against the landlords or against the raising rents. And then you're going to, if you're rich and you can afford a starter home of 250 grand, which will mean that your family has to be on 75 grand a year to be able to get a mortgage, because it's three times your wage. So you're not going to be able to have bricks. So only the rich and the privileged will have bricks and property rights. So they're getting rid of the property rights. And if I can see that as a mammy, I'm amazed. I'm just shocked that so many others can't actually see that. So when we come back to the modulars, actually, what you can see now is Ballymun, they are going in. We have 22 families going into Ballymun. They're ready to go. But the tender, because of the price of it, the tender has gone back out again. So we'll see people coming, developers, and the same, I'm sure it'll be the same people coming up over and over again, coming forward, putting in tenders for our plots of land that they're going to put them onto instead of building real houses. Darndale, Belcamp, there's three sites in the north area, North Dublin area. One of the sites is actually going to be permanent housing, and it's right at the very end of the Traveller site. So you can see the stigmatise that's already happening. And recently, I only heard this morning, actually, is Balbriggan the council have actually refused the proposal of the modulars going in there today. So they want a more in-depth, transparent proposal to come forward before they accept them in Balbriggan. So that's what I know so far.
Okay. We might take another few questions then. Just if you raise your hands, if you have anything to ask.
If you envisage any change in strategy if there is an amalgamation of the water and household charges.
Okay. Any other question over here? Yeah.
We see a while back that you did some kind of a thing of like tenants union, or some kind of you had some meeting about organising tenants into unions. Like, what did you write about that, and like, if there was to be any kind of a campaign around it, like, what, how would that go?
Okay, we'll work away with those two. Mick, if you want to start with the one that's addressed to you, maybe.
Sure, yeah, thanks. So we did, we got the Tenants Union, the International Union of Tenants got in touch with us, and we discovered that in a lot of other countries, hundreds of thousands of tenants are unionised. So the guy who came over to the event that we organised about tenants unions was from the Swedish Tenants Union, and I think they have 700,000 tenants unionised. And at the beginning of every year, they sit down with the Landlords Association and they negotiate whatever stuff is going to happen with rents and with the policy in the sector and so on. So we did organise a meeting to put the idea out there and see what the interest levels were and so on. We want the idea of tenants associations to grow. Ideally, what we would like, our kind of vision was to create a methodology of working that's quite simple, cheap, and easy to replicate, right? So that we would try to come up with a methodology and a model that could easily be reproduced. And so what we'd like to see is tenants associations being set up in other parts of Dublin and indeed across the country to address issues in their area and so on. If that were to happen, you might have the foundations for something more along the lines of a tenants union. But currently, I think it's unrealistic. And I think something that we have all really tried to do with the Tenants Association is to be really realistic and to set achievable goals. I know I sound like a self-help book, but, you know, we've all been through enough campaigns that were based on total Walter Mitty stuff and pie-in-the-sky thinking and stuff that we never really thought would happen. You know, when you're campaigning for stuff that even you don't believe is going to happen. So we had enough of that. So we tried to set very realistic goals. And the reality is that tenants are extremely vulnerable and atomized, and that the appetite for collective action currently is at rock bottom. Zero. It's zero. Like, I think socially and politically now, we are at ground zero in terms of people's capacity to collectively shape their lives. So getting tenants to hand over money, for example, or to sign up to being in a tenants union, I think would fail and would be a waste of time. But I think if you could build up something that's easier to participate in, is simpler and less ambitious, then you can start putting in place the building blocks out of which a tenants movement or sort of housing movement, whatever, could emerge. And from there, you might be in a position to start a tenants union.
Okay. I don't know if you want to address those questions around strategy.
I
want
to go back to Mick. So, right, so Mick, where I get confused with that is, right, because I'm stuck on rent allowance, right, there's two restrictions that I can't, one, return to work and actually make a profit that I'm going to be able to sustain and stay in private rented accommodation, and two is the cap that's on the rent allowance, right? What we can see is there's 65,000 tenants that are actually on rent allowance. So that would mean that there's 65,000 people to mobilise. Do you know what I mean? So why can't we be able to get out there and get them 65,000 people to campaign? We should be able to, because people are fed up. They do want to return to work. And now they're actually being put through homeless services because there's no preventive measures being put in place. So the prevention measures of the private sector for renting are not there by the state, really. We only have thresholds if you really look at it, and then PRTB, but to me, they're biased. But anyway, so when you look back to the list of 65,000, then there's 100,000 on the housing list, and they're... The move of getting rid of social housing onto the housing assistance payments, right, is also going to create more of a problem. So the tenants union is a brilliant idea, but we need to start getting the tenants mobilised, and we can get them mobilised by educating them on exactly what's actually going on in the private sector at the minute. Because when you look at the HAPS, right, the housing assistance payments, right, so it's a 2-year contract. Didn't Minister Kelly just recently bring out that 2 years he can raise the rent? So there's going to be a cap on the HAP as it is, and then in 2 years, when your landlord decides he wants to put up the rent, you're going to have to leave that HAP house, go back through homelessness, and then back into the private sector. So I feel like the target is there. It just means that we actually have to really pull the brains together and target them and get them, empower them to stand up for themselves. And whether it be a union or support groups, it can be done. We just, the numbers are there.
Ryan, do you want to click on that? There's a question there about strategy in the future.
Yeah, I mean, if they're going to amalgamate it with the property tax like they say they're thinking about doing, then I suppose what they can do then is take you to court and put an attachment order on your wages or your income or your dole and just take it straight off you that way. That obviously makes the privatisation thing kind of hard, but it means getting the money out of you will be a bit easier. That would open up the opportunity for hopefully fairly disruptive protests outside of, say, court cases, where you just make as much trouble as you possibly can, just to make it as hard as possible. Because already, like, the court system in Ireland is really fairly overloaded, so judges are probably going to be a little bit hesitant to start bringing in cases that are going to be anything but neat and are going to be extremely disruptive and are going to cause even more problems for them than they already have to deal with on a daily basis. So, I mean, in terms of that, that's kind of how the way I would see it going myself. Maybe other people, I don't know, have other ideas on how to go forward, but that's the immediate thing that I would see anyway.
Okay. We have time for some more questions if anyone has anything to contribute from the floor. Yeah, at the back.
Is the property tax not just being taken out of people's wages and pensions and the old church? There aren't any court cases with the property tax. So why wouldn't there be court cases if they amalgamate them? I'm not quite sure about that.
I can and that's right.
Yeah,
you know, it's being taken from people's wages, and they don't think there's any, you have any recourse.
Okay, fine, Jonah.
Basically, if you're not paying the property tax, then what they can do is they can go to the court and they can kind of force you to do it, and they can take it directly out of your wages. It is just like say road tax, you have to pay it. You just go in and you have to pay it, otherwise they'll chase up on you, and if you don't pay it,
it's
they
not being taken from the pensions and the bill. It just write to your employer and they take it out of your wages.
They can do that if you're not cooperating. But if you are just going in and paying it, then they won't need to do that because you'll just cooperate.
If you're not cooperating, they write to your employer and the employer cooperates.
Yeah.
As far as I know, that's what's happening.
Yeah.
I don't know where the courts are coming in.
Well, I mean, in order to take money off people, if they're, say, on the dole or whatever, you'll have to get an attachment order. You can't just, like, do it. So you'll have to actually bring them to court and get them to get an attachment order, and then they'll just be able to pull it from your income. That's my understanding, anyway.
Can I just say something here?
Yeah.
This is from my brother, and I'm not sure I remember this correctly, but as far as I know, you ordered his employer not to pay the property tax. So far, nothing's happened.
Can't hear you.
My brother ordered his employer not to pay property tax, and so far, nothing has happened. Now, something could happen down the line, but...
We have another question here.
It's not a question, it's just a comment. Oh, I comment. Know of people who it's been taken just directly out of their wages, no court case, no nothing. It's just the property tax is just stolen from them, like they don't bring it to court for it.
Wow, okay, I didn't hear about that. I wasn't aware that they could do that. Mm-hmm. That's,
right. They get revenue to do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay.
Kevin, yeah?
Yeah, just a question for the panel. I mean, I've been involved in the water tax in the Cork area. I mean, from what I've seen, some of it's been very inspirational, and you know, broadly, it's been one of the best things I've seen in many years. And largely, it was down to people organising in their own communities, as was pointed out. So it's been great to see people coming together and really having an effect. And like that stuff we've always talked about for years, people getting empowered by winning is so true. It's been fabulous. I do agree that there's also a whole issue. I mean, it came up in Cork in a couple of areas where there is a large section of people, I think, in our society who would prefer other people to do things for them. And you even found that there was a bit of a tendency in Cork for a kind of a flying column of people to build up around stopping meter installation. And there was loads of people quite happy with that. And for the people who are in the flying column, it's also great, because if they're going around places and they're stopping meters going in, and it's very exciting. But there's nothing like the sort of street meetings that you were talking about there, where you go to people and you say, here's the story, but it's up to you to do it. And they do it. And that's great. And I think the funny thing is, we've seen this fabulous sort of upsurge at a time when, as others pointed out, really, a lot of people were on the back foot in many ways. Austerity has been a great thing for the Irish business community, it seems. So in many ways, loads of people are on the back foot. Yet we've seen this very, very positive grassroots development. Fantastic stuff. I just wonder, where do people see, you know, is it, where will it go on from here, or how can it go on? Will it be like other things? I mean, it's definitely happened in the past, things have petered out, or, you know, they've sort of, you know, just gone again as, you know, one crisis sort of gets given up by another. So where people, or do they think something more will come of it, or can we do something to make more come of it?
Was that specifically about the water movement?
Any of the grassroots?
Yeah.
Because it seems to be broader than
I just say very briefly, I think there's a bit of a, I think for me as a housing activist, there's a question mark around that, because, you know, as you say, the water thing is really inspiring, massively, but there's two kind of things that cause me to have a question. One is that a big part of it is being against a tax. So obviously in Ireland, it's much easier to oppose a tax than it is to propose measures which require an increase in taxation, for example, right? So that's one thing. So it's transferability, I suppose, to other things is there's a question mark around that. The other thing is that the housing thing, or the water thing, was against something new. So we were trying to defend the status quo, if you like. And who was trying to create change was them. So we were just trying to defend things as they are, which is much easier than the housing situation, where we're trying to really propose something that would involve a radical reconfiguration of the housing system, which is much more, it's just much more complex. And there's a much more thinking and education has to go into it because it's so fucking complicated. And that makes it more difficult to identify kind of campaignable things that you can hit on and fight for and easily communicate to people. So it's a question mark for me, isn't it?
Brian?
Yeah, that's a really good question. From our point of view in our campaign, what we started to do was, because housing was becoming such a serious political issue, we started devoting an extra half an hour at the end of our water charge branch meetings onto housing specifically, and just talking about, is there something we can do about this? And people were getting more and more interested in it. So what we ended up doing was, we found specific housing documents, and you would like say... So you would get documents on how to deal with the PRTB, and everybody would read that. And then the next week, you would have a discussion about that, and you would talk about that, and you'd be educating yourself on that. Always with a view to the water charges group now is very concretely on the way into becoming a housing group. It's already effectively, under a different name, Housing Action Kildare, part of the Irish Housing Network with other housing groups. And we've met with members of those housing groups who are a lot more experienced than us, and we're trying to learn maybe how we can find our feet as a housing group and provide similar assistance to people who need it in that kind of area of struggle. So, yeah, I mean, that's the way I see it going. It's very concretely, for us at least, going into housing campaigns.
Ashling,
For me, Jay's, where do I start? I can see a future with it. I might be only a newbie, 2 years doing it, and kind of naive, never been involved in politics, never been involved in that. But we started at the same time as the water movement started, and our community water groups didn't want to know us. They left us behind. They should have taken us with them at the time, but they left us behind. But like that, but we've learned from that, you know what I mean? We've learned now, kind of looking at them, how they organise in the community, and we feel that, even though it might be a big, huge change across the board, but once communities start changing their ideologies and how they can actually start attacking the system and changing, challenging the politicians in the community, then that way that it actually will spread out across the nation. We feel that with the Irish Housing Network, with groups popping up, they're starting to pop up all over the place. We have 6 support groups at the minute. We're hoping to have 10 by the summer. We're growing out with different areas. We now have Clondalkin, Blanchardstown, Lucan, Kildare, Wexford. We've branched out to Cork. We have meetings in Galway. We have research teams setting up. We have laws teams setting up. So basically, it's about having structures, principles and demands and sticking to them. And at least then, what we learned kind of from the water movement was that it was right to change that took that structural kind of thing away from the communities. But what we would feel like is with structures, the principles and demands, that they're kept in the communities and it's you that are leading it, and no politician can actually kind of rob your ideology of what you want to do. So I do see a future for it.
Okay, we have time for maybe 2 more questions. So we've 1 here and then 1 here.
I have actually 2 questions.
Should I... just 1, okay. Yeah.
Right, okay, so I'll ask about the collective action and the tenants thing. So I had only 1 experience with your group, basically. I met a person that experienced your second strategy, so basically where you drop an email or something, you get the information like on a, let's say, self-interested way, so that you can actually resolve your problem, but with the downsides of not having collective action as soon as it's completed. However, I have the feeling that this person now has something that allows her collective action, which is information, because she knows something that she didn't know before. So is it part of your strategy actually to get back to this person in the future and ask opinions, or actually to reply to some emails or calls or whatever it is on similar issues? Because maybe the only problem between the lack of collective action and the self-interest is the fact that some people don't have the information, and especially she's non-Irish, so I guess she even has the, you know, like the jurisdiction is different, you don't know the rules and all that stuff, but she knows something more now. But there is no a second moment of interaction where actually a self-interest can transform itself into, let's say, collective interest.
That's insensitive. To you, do you want to?
Will I just go
yeah,
straight
yeah,
away?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's actually a really, it's a really good idea. And one of the things is we're in the group, we're not that confident sometimes. And, I, you know, for example, to say to somebody, sometimes I want to say to somebody that I've worked with on a case, I want to say to them, look, you're brilliant. You know, you've, because most of the time the tenant does most of the work in the case and you're just helping them to access the information or whatever. And it is the case that sometimes somebody comes with an issue and they've no idea what to do. And then 6 weeks later, you see the same person sit in the PRTB and eat their landlord for breakfast and win a case, you know, and it is, it's a, that's a fascinating thing to see. But we haven't maybe been very good about finding a system to maintain a connection with that person and find it at the second moment that you talked about. We have like monthly social events. So we try to say to people, come for a drink or whatever. That's kind of one way we think might be an avenue back in. But we do need to come up with a system to find a second point of contact and really make it as easy as possible for someone to share what they've learned, but we haven't found. Yeah, I think it's a really great idea though.
Okay, last question then, Pepe. You
no, as not only an international solidarity activist but also as a community activist here, you know, I find great problem in multiplying myself. Okay, have a science fiction machine. And my problem, I'll tell you my problems, my own problems. Okay. I was facing a deportation attempt in February. I have the situation that my landlords increased the rent. With some fellow comrades here from the Stony Batter Water Tax Campaign, we've been fudging the water tax, burning the water bills and all that, you know. I'm paying peanuts. And I could keep going on. All these problems, you know, and usually I tend to have problems with the Gardaí for whatever reason, they decom me. Okay? So you have all those problems and you have to flock from one campaign to the other. And every time an issue emerges, we flock from this campaign. So housing crisis, I should flock all there. And then you see more or less the same people in the water campaign, in different campaigns. But what I think, and really this is something that I would like comments from everyone really, it's how, because I can't really go to all the campaigns and I try to stick to whatever is more urgent, you know, but I am actually screwed by many flanks. And I really would like to see how these campaigns could start having more of a dialogue and how they could cross-pollinate. Something like that.
Pollinate.
Not my first language, sorry. but building these bridges and building these channels so we actually take a more proactive approach in defending ourselves as communities. And as communities, we are facing a crisis which is actually multidimensional. It can't be reduced to the one tax, to the one service, to one charge, to the one problem. It's multidimensional. Mm-hmm. And we need to see how we're going to be building more links there to build a proper community strength. And that's a crisis. Because sometimes we don't even know the name of our neighbors.
Yeah.
So our communities are in crisis. And I want to see what we can do about it. Or some ideas.
Okay. Mick, and then we'll...
Maybe somebody else can start. I don't know. It's a hard question. Hopefully, we're running out of time and I have to answer.
Do
you want me to do it? Start.
Yeah, Ashley, you can start.
From what I was picking up on that, with the network, what we feel is that all groups should be involved in the network. Like that, we have LinkedIn with the anti-racism network. And we feel like if you had that problem with a housing issue, then you'd have that support of both. We feel that. The way I seen it in North Dublin Bay was like that, we should be all linked together. Like, we tried to link in with the water movement, we tried to link in with this homeschool liaison officer, we tried to have a good meeting with everybody that was a service user or a service provider within the community, and we had a conference and we tried to bring all that together. Because what we felt was that you have a council in your community and it's led by political parties that only have the interest of the political policy and not actually the community itself. And then when it was going through the council, it's all secretive and anyway, and it's not transparent. So what we feel is that there should be a community council, and this is North Dublin Bay, kind of as our own kind of being in the community and understanding like that. We don't know who the neighbour is. We don't know the travellers down on the site. We don't know, and everyone has a complex of kind of different issue, and the services, it's about linking into the services as well. So if we could amalgamate all the kind of different movements that were happening in a community and it's based in the community, then I think that would really help with the movements going forward. So I agree with you.
Brian,
so yeah, I mean, my understanding of the question is that, like, how we should kind of link lots of different types of campaigns together.
Yeah.
So for us, obviously we started out as the kind of water charges. Pardon?
Sorry, they're calling me out for some reason. I don't know.
No worries. I'll answer generally anyway. It's being recorded. Exactly. I'll try my best to answer that in absentia. We're obviously water charges group, but we have connections to, say, Palestine solidarity campaigns. We've got people who are kind of relatives of people who are active in the campaign, who are getting active in pro-choice stuff. There's people who are close to the campaign who've been involved in, say, the Yes Equality campaign, for example. So, like, I suppose when people get politically active, it makes it really easy to link up with other people. And, I mean, generally, I think people's politics in my group are generally reasonably good. Like, I mean, obviously, nobody's going to be perfect. No political group is ever going to be perfect. But I think that we're linking up. We're actually probably going to be linking up with a direct provision campaigner in Kildare probably in the next couple of weeks, just to educate us a little bit on direct provision and maybe see if we can tie up with people on that. So it is really... once people get active, the networks just kind of start to form. It's just something that happens very organically. So, and that is happening with us at least.
Mick?
Yeah, I don't know. It's a really complicated. It's a really complicated question. I think for me, now is the time to focus more on self-organizing around concrete issues. That's to illustrate it. And until you have that a bit stronger, I think there's a danger of trying to go too far too fast. And if you start to get a load of already disparate groups who are finding it difficult just to keep the show on the road as is, to try and come together and find some kind of a shared platform, you're in a danger of fostering that can be divisive and be counterproductive, potentially. So that'd be a question I've had. The other thing I'd say is I think it's unlikely. I mean, maybe in the past people came together from different campaigns around a shared critique of the society they lived in or a shared vision for a different type of society. So, for example, they might be drawn together by anarchism or socialism or by a critique of capitalism. So that would be a kind of a unifying force. I think that's unlikely to be the case now, to be honest with you. And I think maybe more so stuff around what you talked about in terms of at a local and community level, linking in together and going back to what Ashton said about emotional and issues around human relations and compassion would be more likely if you were to have spaces or structures at a community level that brought people together to know each other face to face and be able to relate to each other. On that level, I think it would probably be more productive than maybe a more traditional, say, right to change type approach, like everybody signed up to my, you know, manifesto or a particular set of beliefs or whatever.
No, I agree with you.
Okay. I'm going to have to... Okay. Just before we go, I just want us to show our appreciation for Mick, Brian and Aisling.
Hello, my goodness.